On this kind of engineering, which led to his award of the Engineer Historian Award of the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. I'm not sure what that was, but I didn't know. Congratulations.
Thank you, Matt.
And today he's going to talk about the R101 airship disaster and the broken delivery.
Thank you. Well, good evening to you all. I must admit I'm surprised to see so many, with the flu and the rail strike, and heaven knows what. It's, I suppose I might be talking to myself for a short time. But anyway, here we are. As you can see from the title, I'm talking about the R101 airship disaster, and you also get, for your money, some information on the broken elevator cable, which sort of dropped out of history, and I'm going to try and put it back. It was always known that the elevator cable on the R101 broke during the crash. It was discovered by the accident investigators and reported to the Court of Inquiry. But what happened was that the court determined, for very good and proper reason, that the elevator cable had snapped after the accident, after the crash, not before. And therefore it couldn't be a cause of the crash and was irrelevant. And thereafter, it was ignored by on Sunday. And in fact, I, doing research for this, I came across a paper by Davidson, published in the Journal of Aeronautical History. I was going to say last year, the year before now, 2015. And it's about 165 pages long, and devoted to the R101 disaster. And it simply consists of quotations from all that's been published since that day. So it's a vast subject, and I went through there, and there's a single mention of a broken elevator cable. So what I want to do today is try to address that, and I want to try to demonstrate that the course of the inquiry was, in my view at least, wrongly coming to that conclusion, and that in fact the broken elevator cable was responsible for the second and fatal dive of the airship, and was therefore quite important. So before I get into all the technical detail of that, I thought I might run over the general history of the R101 so that you know roughly speaking where it came from. I'm sure most of you know the story already, so it would just be a matter of reminding you. Right. Let's see if I can get this to work. Oh, did you all manage to hear it there?
Yes.
Oh, fine. And this is a microphone that's on. I think it's fine. Yes, that gives you something to look at while I'm talking, I suppose. The R101 and the R100 grew up together out of a scheme that was proposed by Sir Denniston Burney in 1923. And what he proposed, he founded the Airship Guarantee Company, and what he proposed was to join up all the red areas of the map and run airship services throughout the empire. And so he wanted to run services from England to Canada, from England to Egypt, and then on to India, and eventually on to South Africa and into Australia and New Zealand. He put the scheme up to the Tory government of the time. And the Air Minister was very impressed by this, and he got support. He won support for building six large airships, each of 5 million cubic foot capacity. And these airships were twice the size of the wartime Zeppelins, so they were very large indeed. And excuse me, he won the government support for this. But unfortunately, the government, the Tory government, lost the next election. This sort of thing happens. And the result was that the Labour government, the first Labour government, came to power. And they weren't very fond of the idea of giving large sums of money to private industry, as you might imagine. So they altered the scheme. They reduced it from six airships to only two. One would be built by Gurney's... Burney's Airship Guarantee Company, and the other, that was the R100, and the other would be built by the Government Airship Works at Cardington, that's the R101. That was their official designations. There was also some unofficial designations. The government ship was called the socialist ship, and the R100 was called the capitalist ship. And it was all seen as a sort of battle between socialism and capitalism. But capitalism is a sort of misnomer for the R101, mainly because it was all short of capital. It was built on a ship still. But the R101 was much better supported. It had government funds behind it. And it also had all the R&D facilities of the government research and development laboratories. They were supposed to share this information, and some of it certainly was shared, but not all of it was. So there was always a sort of competition between the two. Anyway, here you can see the R101 at its mooring mast. In 1929, it took 5 years to build. They both took 5 years to build, amazingly slow. The Germans got on with their airships much faster. You can see the building of the airship here at Carrington. Huge gas bags inside a rigid frame. The airships have the same specification, but rather different designs emerged. The R100 was designed by Barnes Wallace, and surprisingly, it was the least innovative of the two. Most of the innovation took place on the R101, which is not to say that the R100 didn't have new aspects to its design, but it was the least new ship. They were of about 5.5 million cubic foot capacity. The gross lift of R100 was 156 tonnes, as against only 148.6 tonnes on the R101. The R101 was very heavy. It was 109.9 tonnes, as opposed to 102 tonnes for the other. And the reason for this heaviness was partly they made the frame not out of pure aluminium, but out of stainless steel. Which may have been a mistake in retrospect. They also had diesel engines rather than petrol engines. And the diesel engines they got were heavier than initially specified, and they didn't produce as much power as specified. So they were both heavier and underpowered. The net result was that the R100 came up to spec. And it was able in 1929 to take off and do the transatlantic flight to Canada. The R101 was scheduled to go to India, but it wasn't capable of taking the load. Its disposable load was only, I think I've got it down here, 38 tons. As opposed to 54 tons, it was supposed to be over 50 tons. So it was. It had to go back into its sheds. It had to be cut in half and extended by adding an additional bay, which made it longer, but we were able to put into the ship an additional gas bag, which gave it the additional lift. So the extended version, they managed to get a lift of 53.5 tons, which still was a little bit less than it had been achieved by the R100, but nevertheless, it was now fit to go on these long distance voyages. I should say that the R100 was the fastest ship I think that was ever built. It was quite remarkable. And one of the other inventions, if you like, or discoveries, was that wartime Zeppelins were very long and thin. They had an aspect ratio of about 12 to 1 or 10 to 1. These had an aspect ratio of about 5 to 1 or 6 to 1. And that wind tunnel test had shown that for minimum drag for a given volume, an aspect ratio of a length of depth weight, a length of diameter ratio of about 5 or 6 to 1 was the best. And that's what they were designed for. Just to show you how heavy these airships were in comparison with wartime Zeppelins, I've got a graph here which shows the vertical scale
is the disposable lift, and the horizontal scale is the airship size, its volume. And you can see that Zeppelins ran up to 2 million tonnes or thereabouts, whereas these two ships ran up to 5 or more million cubic feet capacity. And they were very heavy. There's a good reason for this in comparison with the Zeppelins. The Zeppelins were wartime ships that were designed to take a maximum bomb load, and improvements in aircraft design had driven them up to 20, 22,000 feet altitude. So they had to be capable of getting right up to that sort of altitude. This meant that they were very lightly constructed, whereas these had to carry passengers safely, and they were very heavily constructed. And you can see that they're about twice as heavy really as they could have been. The transitions from one slide to the next are always quite entertaining these days. I think some of them are more entertaining than the slides, but we will see how we get on with them. This shows the R101, but it's mooring mast and also being brought out of its shed. It took 400 men to haul it out of the shed and handle it on the ground. It was an amazing number of men. That, of course, is very expensive. So the invention and development of good mooring masts was ideal. In practice, these airships would have flown from one mooring mast to the next. And what happened is that you let out the cable from the top of the mooring mast onto the ground into the middle of the airfield, and an approaching airship would let out a cable from its nose onto the ground, and instead of 400 men, you had two men who would couple them together, and then an electric winch would haul the cable in and draw the ship to the universal joint at the top of the mooring mast. And it was a much more sensible way of dealing with airships. It did mean that you had to erect a little bridge between the mooring mast and the nose of the airship, which on the photographs I've seen, very flimsy. And all the passengers and goods and services had to go into and out of the airship along this bridge. But it was a great improvement. Whilst the R101 was being modified, the R100 took off across the Atlantic very successfully and went to Montreal. Here you see crowds of people on the skyscrapers in Montreal welcoming the ship. And she was given 2 weeks of celebration fêting. There were lunches and receptions and dinners, and great crowds of people wanted to come aboard the airship to see them, and there were organised trips and special editions of newspapers and magazines and that sort of thing. It was a great triumph for them. They returned across the Atlantic to England, where the welcome was cooler. They were given, in effect, a slap on the back and a well done. All eyes were on the R101 at this time, which was coming out of its modifications and was preparing for the flight to India. The Air Minister, the Tory government, fell once again just at a critical time, and the Labour government came back, and Lord Thompson was Air Minister, and he, having initiated the two airship scheme, he decided he would like to fly to India on the inaugural flight of the R101, and he insisted on being back for the Imperial Conference, which was being held on the 20th of October, which meant that they must leave by the 4th of October. The ship wasn't ready. It was brought out of its sheds and did some preliminary flying. It never flew on full power. After sailing around on part power, they discovered that there were thousands of small holes in all the airbags, all the gas bags, holes about the size of a coin. I don't know how many, but I do know that the Royal Airship Works ordered 3,000 patches to put over these holes. So there was a large number, and it was leaking hydrogen rather badly. And the reason for this was that in order to increase the lift, they'd made the bags larger, and they were now rubbing against the inside of the metal frame, the stainless steel frame, and that was creating these hundreds of holes, thousands of holes. There was an answer. They wrapped padding around the stainless steel structure, so that instead of rubbing against stainless steel, we were now rubbing against padding. And that was thought to be the answer, but they never tested it. They didn't know that it was the answer. But time was getting close. The Air Minister was insisting, and they took up on the 4th of October. On the 3rd of October, they didn't have an airworthiness certificate. Professor Bairstow was chairman of the airworthiness certificate, and he hadn't written his report saying that she was fit to fly. And he didn't know that. He didn't complete his report until after she crashed. He hadn't even checked the stress calculations, which was quite appalling. And certainly no one had checked that the engine was capable of running for any sustained length of time on full power. And no one had checked that the padding on the airship would be intact. So all this was going on, but nevertheless the Air Minister was insisting. In my view, he was criticised by the Court of Inquiry. And he was the only person, really, who was criticised by the Court of Inquiry. I think Professor Bairstow, who was a professor here at Imperial College, I think it was up to him to refuse to sign the airworthiness certificate, because he didn't know that it was airworthy. But he was under pressure, he signed it, he thought he could get away with it. He didn't, of course. But anyway, they took off. And this is the flight plan that I managed to dig out of Q, the official plan that the Court of Inquiry prepared. The R101 left in the early evening, about 6:30, I think, from Carlington. It passed over London, passed over Hastings, and then over the Channel. She passed over the Channel at about 1,000 feet, which was comparatively low. When she took off, the wind was quite bad. It was they were took off in a 30 mile an hour breeze. Sir Peter Masefield's book, it was written 50 years after the event in 1981, it's called To Ride the Storm. And it does give the impression that she took off and had to cope with the storm. It wasn't. A storm is Beaufort scale 12 and 70 miles an hour. This was Beaufort scale 6. It was a strong wind, dangerous enough for an airship, but it certainly wasn't a storm. Anyway, they decided to leave, and the wind got worse steadily, and it was up to 40 miles an hour by the time they reached Beauvais in France, just south of Beauvais, where they crashed. The ground speed was of the order of 30 miles an hour. But it was set on cruising. The engines were running at cruising speed, which meant that the speed relative to the air would have been around 60 miles an hour. So you can see they had 30 mile an hour headwinds to cope with. They crashed. Oh, I went the wrong way. Oh, this is the flight log. Do I need to go from this? I can say it. I think I've already said it. She slipped from the tower at 18:30, about 6:30, and she went on her way. And she reported that the cloud base was 1,500 feet, so she would not exceed 1,500 feet, because in order to navigate an airship at that time, the navigator had to have his eyes on the ground. He had to see the ground, so she would stay below the height. The cloud base, and it was reported all the way along from France and England that the cloud base was 1,500 feet, so that gives her a maximum height for her flight. crossing the channel, she crossed 1,000 feet, and evidently was having trouble maintaining that because the chief coxswain took over and brought her back up to 1,000 feet when she dropped to 800. And I think that was simply the inexperience of the crew that we were using. They hadn't had sufficient time to get used to the aircraft, the airship, and how she behaved. So they were receiving training en route. In fact, en route to India, they had to do their speed trials. Everything was so rushed. She crashed. These are a couple of aerial photographs. You can see them. She crashed nose down on the edge of a wood, just south of Beauvais in France. And you can see that the middle section is very much wrecked. Looking at that, I think there are two ways in which the airship was damaged. Either the joints fractured, in which case the longitudinal slid one over the other, and there's some evidence of that. Or if the joints held, then the longitudinal was buckled. And I think you can see in the centre of the ship, they were tending to buckle, whereas at the front, they slid one over the other more. She obviously came down nose first. And there was a witness, a Monsieur Rabouille, who happened to be out at 2 o'clock in the morning on a stormy, windy night, looking for rabbits in the French countryside. Not to put too fine a point on it, he was a poacher. Anyway, he got the shock of his life because along came this huge airship, and it crashed into the ground about 250 yards from where he was. So he had a good view of the whole thing. And he reported, he fled. And he had to be persuaded to give his evidence in exchange for an agreement not to take him to court for poaching. Anyway, that was done. He gave his evidence. And he spoke to some reporters from the Daily Telegraph. And 8 days after the crash, the Daily Telegraph reported almost exactly what had happened. I think. I may have to read a little bit here. Oh dear. Portrait evidence. he says that she seemed to be. I should paraphrase rather than quote the whole thing. It would go on forever otherwise. She, meaning the airship, was fighting hard in drenching rain, and her engines were running all out. Suddenly she dipped, descended a short way, then levelled out, and sank slowly towards the earth, nose down. A loud explosion from the forepart of the ship was heard, followed by two further explosions. He thought that a blast of wind had brought her down, and as she settled, she broke her back and the structure collapsed. But that didn't happen until after she hit the ground, so she didn't fall out of the sky because of a broken structure. And her engines also were still running when she hit the ground. So that was his account. Unfortunately, it was reported in the Daily Telegraph, but when he came to give his evidence at the Institution of Civil Engineers here in London, at the Court of Inquiry, which was another 3 weeks later, he changed his story. She didn't come down as one dive, a recovery, and a second dive. She came down in a single dive. He was asked at what angle she came down, and they had a model of the airship there with a protractor on, and so he adjusted the protractor and looked at it from various angles, and then declared that he was satisfied that that was the angle at which she hit the ground. They measured the angle and found it to be 28 degrees. Now, the accident investigators had got over to France Within 12 hours of the accident, it happened at 2 o'clock in the morning. They were there by 3 o'clock in the afternoon on the Sunday. And great crowds of French people were, as you can see, had gathered there. But they examined the wreck, they made accurate drawings. They had a firm of French surveyors in to make accurate drawings of the wreck. They took photographs, aerial photographs and ground photographs, and they examined everything they could. They interviewed the survivors. There were eight survivors, strictly speaking, two of whom died shortly afterwards of their burns in hospital. So there were six, what you might call, long-term survivors. They interviewed the survivors and got their evidence, and then returned to England to present their results to the court. Monsieur Rabouille changed his story somewhat. He said she came down in one. The QC examining him asked the court's permission to raise the matter of the Daily Telegraph report, and the court refused to give that permission and said they were satisfied that he was his memory was what it was, and they would accept it for what it was, and they couldn't say whether the report that was made on his behalf by the Daily Telegraph report was accurate or not. In fact, it was accurate, because all the conclusions of the Court of Inquiry after several weeks' inquiry was exactly as I described it earlier, which is why I went to that trouble. It came down in two dives, the partial recovery halfway down, hit the ground nose first, not at an angle of 28 degrees, but the investigators found that the angle of impact was between 15 degrees and 25 degrees, and that the engines, at least one engine, was still running, according to the survivors. Most of the survivors were in the engine pods, which were protruding beneath the airship. So the engineers survived and said that all the engines had been shut off except one. But the other evidence that was given was that everyone heard the engines being closed down at different times. For example, some people heard the engine, closed down an engine that signaled the ship's telegraph, and then the engineer had to go over to the engine and shut it down and signal back to the team. And there were five of these pots, so closing down engines was a long business. They successfully closed four of them down, but one of the engineers said that he didn't close down his engine before she struck the ground, so we know that one of them was still running. They also gave permission, asked for the ballast to be released, because one of the survivors, Rigger Church, he was a vicar, he was sent forward, I think he was sent to his death in fact, he was sent to the nose of the ship and told to release the water at the very nose, the ballast at the nose, and he didn't reach the nose, but he survived the crash and died a few days later in hospital just after giving evidence that the ballast at the nose of the ship hadn't been released, but presumably all the other ballast, much of which could be released from the control car, was released to try to avoid the impact. Anyway, the Court of Inquiry met in December, November and December, and they heard all this evidence. Monsieur Rabouille, as I said, didn't give a different account, but they heard the expert witnesses, and all of them seemed to give variable accounts. Some of them said that the first dive was very steep, and some of them said the first dive was so shallow that they didn't notice it. Some people said the second dive was very steep, and they differed about the length of time of the recovery phase between the two dives. One person said it was 45 seconds, and another one said it was 5 seconds, and so on. So the evidence really was all over the place. The Court of Inquiry picked their way through this evidence and came to what they thought was the most likely scenario, and published that in their report. They also heard expert evidence from Dr. Eckner, who was the president and captain of the Zeppelin company. and he came across to give his expert evidence. They heard expert evidence also from the captain of the R101, the squadron leader Booth. They heard experts from the Royal Ordnance, the Royal Airship Works, and they heard expert evidence from Professor Bearstore. And his theory was interesting but not adopted. He thought that gas was escaping gradually through all these small holes in the airships, airbags. And gradually the ship became heavy as she proceeded. And the captain would know this, of course. And sensibly, he would turn back to base and have the problem fixed. But he reckoned that once they'd lost, he produced some graphs which showed that once she'd lost 14 tons of lift, she would fall out of the sky. And that's what he thought may well have happened. The more practical men, the ones with experience of flying airships, took a different point of view. They thought that the captain of the R101 would have returned to base as soon as he found the ship getting heavy. And therefore, it must have been a sudden event and not a gradual event. And they favoured the sudden loss of lift from one of the forward gas bags. And this would put the nose down and she would come down. The elevator control helmsman, coxswain, would attempt to recover from this by putting the elevator up, and that accounted for the recovery from the first dive. For some reason, they say that he decided that he couldn't recover before hitting the ground, and the best thing to do would be to have a gentle impact with the ground. So he cut all the engines, and he dropped all his ballast, and he gradually came to earth. Airships had done this before and survived, but unfortunately he didn't. He came to ground, and despite having so-called safe diesel engine, diesel engines with so-called safe fuel, nevertheless, the hydrogen escaped. There was a spark. It ignited the hydrogen, and the whole thing was an inferno. The Air Minister lost his life, of course, and all the top brass from the Air Minister died in the crash. It was really a rather sickening experience for the country. Nevertheless, they heard all this evidence, and they decided that the leak of a forward gas bag was probably the most likely cause of the crash. They were very worried because of the broken elevator cable, which I haven't mentioned yet. But when Major Cooper, who was the chief investigator of the crash, went over to France, he almost immediately found a broken elevator cable. I think you can see on this that the rear part of the ship is almost intact, and the fin that protruded below the ship, of course, had trenched up, but the rest of the rear end was more or less intact. But you can see the elevator here is in the down position. In that position, the airship would go nose down and crash into the ground. They must have been very worried that that, in fact, was what had happened. But when they investigated the cable, they found that the cable wrapped around the drum, and all the cable that should have been on the drum was on the drum. So the elevator at the time must have been in a fallop condition, i.e. the elevator coxswain was trying to recover from the crash when something happened. They thought perhaps the elevator cable had broken. But in fact, they were very worried about the cable, because when they examined it, it was made out of steel. 12 strands of steel wire, about 50 thousandths of an inch diameter. This cable had snapped, and when they examined the end of it under a pocket microscope, they discovered that the ends, instead of being a ductile fracture, which is what they would have expected,
it was, in fact, a pittle fracture, which is rather odd. And they couldn't understand this at all, so they took all the gear all the way from the control camp all the way back to the elevator and had it transferred to England for examination. It was examined by the Royal Airship Works at Cardington. It was examined by Cambridge University and by Wright's wires up in Birmingham, who made the wire, and also by the Birmingham City laboratories. So lots of people had a look at this wire, and they discovered that it was about 5 or 10% below its specified breaking strain. But they couldn't account for the fracture, except that the gentleman, Church Ward, from Cambridge University, solved the problem for them. He took a piece of the cable out of the ship and pulled it in a tensile testing machine, and it broke in a ductile manner with necking. He then took another piece of wire out of the cable from the ship, and he put it onto a low load on a tensile testing machine. And this time, he played a hydrogen flame onto the wire, and after 1.5 minutes, the wire heated up to 900 degrees C, whereupon it snapped. And when they looked at the fracture, they discovered it was a brittle fracture. Aha, he had the answer. The wire had snapped after the crash and had snapped during the hydrogen fire that occurred after the crash. He wrote all this up on a report, which I managed to find in Kew. It's 1.5 pages long, and it's in a pile of papers sewed in. So you really do have to look for it. He was very admirably brief in his description of what he did. And the Court of Inquiry totally accepted his explanation. The elevator cable was irrelevant because it broke, presumably by hydrogen embrittlement, in the hydrogen fire that occurred after the accident. It was not there for the cause of the accident. This is one of the drawings that were done, and you can see the edge of the wood there, and the damaged forepart, which is mostly in the wood, and the more or less intact rear part. And this shows the angle at which he came down. The importance of this diagram, from my point of view, is that it shows, I don't have a pointer, I'm afraid.
This one?
Is it one on the picture? I can't see one here. The point is that the frames, the number of frames that are shown in their original positions here, and they're also shown in their positions on the ground, there are series of numbers here. So it's possible to find out how these frames moved during the crash. And the accident investigators found that the overall length of the airship had shrunk by 8 feet. It was about 800 feet long, so it was 10% short. It was quite a lot. Now this is where we abandon the Court of Inquiry, and I start my explanation of how this could have happened. I believe that if the airship had shrunk 88 feet, as was reported by the accident investigators, and it's confirmed by these drawings here, then we can draw. I forgot this one. I thought as I was talking about the cable, I might mention, show you the way in which the cable runs from the control room, which is round about frame 6, about half, two-thirds away, about a third away from the nose of the ship. It runs along the ship, and when it reaches frame 14, it runs across the top there, then down an angle to a pulley. his pulley was originally a servo motor, and it was they had servo assisted steering. But clearly, if the ship was too heavy, they had to get rid of wings. And one of the things they got rid of was the servo assist. So this was now virtually a statistical reduction pulley. So the cable went to that pulley. There was another cable that ran from the pulley to this device here, which was one of their clever inventions. What happened is that if you move this from side to side, the elevator flapped up and down, so it was quite a neat little way of operating the elevator, which was patented. So, and it's just shown there in diagrammatic form. And from there, that scale on top there is the elevator. Then runs along this firm 15 to the to the starboard elevator and operates that and so on. So that gives you an idea of the plan. Also, on this diagram, it tells you that the cable moved 12 feet 10 inches. And I think that's the maximum movement of the cable. And it corresponds to the elevator moving from 25 degrees down to 25 degrees up. So it gives us a bit of additional information. There's also a gas bag there, you can see at the right hand side. And I found this at the bottom of a box of photographs, folded in half. I'm sorry about the priest out in the middle. It's annotated, and it doesn't say what it is. Most of the others do, but this one doesn't. The date in the bottom right-hand corner, I'm afraid, my camera put that there. I took a photograph last, in November 2015, some time ago. This is a 2-to-1 reduction box, and pulley. And there you can see the wires going to the pulley, and Major Cooper, I assume, is holding the wire two halves of the broken wire, so we do have a photograph of the broken wire. The one he's holding is the wire that comes from the control room to the pulley. The one that broke and caused all the damage ran from the small diameter pulley to the elevator, but both broke. Oh, incidentally, I remember I put this one in simply because it shows this wonderful little device that they invented. As the wire moves that up and down, the rudder moves back and forth like that. So that's this little invention. This is how the airship came down, of course. In two dives. The first dive caused, presumably, by the bursting of one of the forward gas fans. A recovery when the coxswain put the elevator into hard up, and he reached the 25 degrees full up condition. At that point, I believe the elevator cable broke. I mentioned Cambridge. I think I've spoken about all these things. Oh, I haven't spoken about this. I ought to go back a little while. The Court of Inquiry came to the conclusion that the airship had fallen out of the sky in the way I described. However, they wanted mathematical confirmation of this. So the National Physical Laboratory was persuaded to do the calculations to show the way in which this double dive and recovery could have happened. And they set about making a mathematical model and dividing the equations and solving those equations. So this is the mathematical model they developed. I'm not going to go through it in detail, but you can see that all the forces acting on the airship are illustrated there, and the essential geometry of the airship. Two things I should mention is usually the mass times local gravity of the airship is equal and opposite to the the buoyancy of the airship F. So those two terms cancel out. And you're left with this small term W, which is the heaviness of the ship. The ship might be slightly heavy or slightly light, depending on whether you drop some ballast or you use some fuel, or it's rain and the rain is collected on the skin of the ship. So it might be slightly heavy or slightly light relative to what it should be. And that's the exact notation that they used, and I've copied it. I've not changed anything. These are the equations they derived. There's a first order differential equation, in fact six first order differential equations. The top one is for the motion along the axis of the ship. The third one down is for motion across the axis of the ship. And the bottom one is for the rotation of the ship, pitch and so on. And there are various other additional equations which are necessary. I suppose I might mention this one, since it gave me some trouble. But when they did some wind tunnel tests on the airship, they measured the drag horizontally and the lift vertically, which is D and L there. So the resultant force acting on the ship is the force R. But what we need to solve these equations is the force X, that is the direction of the force acting on the axis of the ship, and the force Z, which is acting across the axis of the ship. So from the measurements of D and L, you have to calculate X and Z. And that little construction does it for you. I made the mistake of not doing that, and it took me 3 months of scratching my head to figure it out, I'm ashamed to say. There's also some additional equations for finding the horizontal vertical velocities, as opposed to the axial and transaxial velocities. There are some damping coefficients for the airship. These were also measured in the wind tunnel. So again, we used their damping coefficients. And Professor Bairstow worked out the thrust of the engines, thrust of the propeller, as a function of speed. So again, that was used. And these are the measurements of the lift, the drag, and the pitching moment that they got from the model of the airship. The model, I think, was around 6 feet. In fact, it was about a 1 in 217 scale model. So it's quite a big model. They ran it in the top left-hand corner, this is the drag, and what we have is the drag force vertically, and the horizontal scale is the pitch angle of so the drag change a bit. You get the minimum drag, of course, when the pitch angle is zero. If you pitch up, then the drag increases. If you pitch down, the drag increases. But when you, because of these curves are not quite symmetrical, because the protrusions on the underside of the airship, the fire engine pods and the control group, whereas the top is quite smooth, and therefore they're not quite symmetrical. For example, the top curve marked as a minus 20, if you follow that down to the other side of the graph, it becomes, instead of being the top curve, it becomes the bottom curve. So it's highly asymmetrical. But the top right-hand corner is the lift, so as you alter the pitch angle, you either produce lift or you produce the opposite lift, you produce negative lift. And of course, you get a different lift depending on the elevator angle. If you alter the elevator angle, you will also get a lift. So the lift and the drag and the pitching moment are all functions of the pitch angle and the elevator angle. This is the pitching angle, so generally speaking, if it's running nose up, there will be a pitching angle tending to lift the nose. If it's running nose down, there will be an angle tending to depress the nose. There will be a moment tending to depress the nose. The NPL solves these equations. I mean, it's quite a set of equations to solve with a digital computer even today. But they set about it using a 20-inch slider. And also they had graph paper, all that material there was on the graph. and they had log tables. That's what they had. And they solved these six differential equations using step lengths varying from 0.1 of a second, 1 second or 2 seconds. Most of their calculations were done with 1 or 2 second intervals. When I did my computer simulation of this, my software, I brought in the software to do it, I wasn't going to write a program. I brought in the software to do it, and it wouldn't allow me to use such crude step lengths as 2 seconds. I had to use 1/100 of a second. You know, you make the step length smaller and smaller until the answer you're getting stops changing. And when it stops changing, you know your step length is small enough to be accurate. And 1/100 of a second is really what you needed. But they used, at the best, they used 1/10 of a second. And it was, I had nothing but admiration for the engineers and scientists who did this at the MPL. It was a massive solve. Not only did they solve these equations once, they solved them 14 times and presented their results to the Court of Inquiry. In fact, the Court of Inquiry had finished, and the report was written by the time these calculations were done. But nevertheless, they were incorporated in the final published result. The results were also published as an R&M paper, a separate R&M paper, so you can find the NPL calculations very easily at most libraries, I guess. They made 13 attempts. The trouble was that she fell down North West all right, and she recovered all right, but after that, she came down on her belly. She wouldn't come down pointing 15 degrees or 25 degrees nose down. That's alone 28 degrees. She kept coming down on her belly. So they adopted various tricks to try and get her to come down nose first. And they had 14 attempts at this before they got a satisfactory result. And some of the attempts, for instance, the Royal Aircraft Works had suggested that when gas leaked out of the gas bags, it was trapped between the gas bags and the outer cover. And as the ship went nose down, this hydrogen would move to the back of the ship and would lift the tail. And that would make her even more nose down. That was just the sort of thing they wanted. So they incorporated that into their calculations. But still, it wouldn't come down at the requisite angle. They tried all several things they could. Eventually, they decided that there must have been a puff of wind. She must have sailed into a downwind gust of wind on the nose, which blew her down. And so they incorporated that into their computer calculations. And eventually, they got her to crash at something like the requisite angle. And the Court of Inquiry was quite satisfied with that. Here are their calculations. Height loss on the vertical scale and distance travelled on the horizontal scale. And the little horizontal lines up along the path that you took represent the angle, the pitch angle of the ship. And the thing is that it was flying officially, according to the court, at 1,200 feet. She crashed at an altitude of 270. The hillside was an altitude of 270 feet above sea level. So she would only have lost 930 feet when she crashed. Had she been flying as high as possible, that is, immediately under the cloud base, which was 1,500 feet, then she would lose 1,500 feet minus 270, which I think is 1,230. She would have lost 1,230 feet. And you can see on these calculations that when she lost 1,000 feet, she was almost horizontal. She was 0.2 degrees nose down. When she lost 1,270 feet, she was down about 6 degrees nose down, so it was 0.5 degrees nose down, which was highly unsatisfactory. The people at NPL realised this, but the Court of Inquiry decided in their wisdom that this was quite a good result, and that had she lost 1,500 feet, she would be at an angle of 13.5 degrees nose down, which is something like what they expected.
and they decided that these calculations were quite acceptable. The NPL engineers and scientists didn't agree. They did one additional calculation, which is a bit controversial. They said, supposing we take away the gust of wind that actually on her nose and all the other things that brought her down, and we just allow, correction. Supposing we leave the gust of wind in place and all the other things that act on the ship to bring her nose down, and leave all those in place, but instead of stopping the engine and releasing all the ballast, suppose we just release all the ballast but keep the engine running. So they repeated the calculation. The only thing they did differently was that they left the engine running. And this is what they calculated. They found that she would lose about 140 feet, something like that, and then recover her altitude. And she would then be quite able to turn around and head back towards home. You will have noticed, incidentally, on the aerial shots of the airship, that she was still pointing in the direction of, if I say Egypt, I don't know what I mean, she was still on course. She hasn't turned back and was heading back home. But she could have done so, had she not stopped her engines. And this was quite controversial, because it meant that the chief coxswain Hunt, who survived the crash, who died in the crash, was responsible for saying, stop the engines, drop the ballast. Had he not said stop the engine, they would have recovered, and they would not have crashed. And this was stated in the official report. However, he wasn't criticised for this decision. They said it was quite correct. It was not quite correct. It was exactly the wrong decision. Your instinct tells you that if you're losing height and you want more lift, you travel faster and generate more dynamic lift. And that's what should have happened. But they did. He didn't. He decided to make a gentle landing. For some reason, I think he did it for a good and proper reason, namely that he'd lost his elevator. However, assuming the elevator was still running, he decided to make a soft landing. And that was a big mistake. It was a big mistake, especially because one of the chief coxswain from the R100 that made a successful trip across the Atlantic gave evidence. And he said that in 1921 he had been aboard the R33. And the R33 had suffered a similar catastrophe. In fact, one of the regulars fell through the gas bags. Sounds fairly serious. But anyway, he fell through the gas bags, leaving a big hole. There was a massive loss of gas. The ship fell 500 feet. It had been at a height of 2,000 feet. It fell 500 feet before they were able to regain control. They regained control by operating the elevators, of course, by dropping ballast and by putting the engines on full power. And by putting the engines on full power, they came up from their low position up to 3,000 feet. And at 3,000 feet, they managed to get the airship into decent trim, and she returned home to her base. Putting the engines onto full power was the way to have saved the R101. The chief coxswain wasn't criticised for this. In fact, in Sir Peter Masefield's book on the disaster, he says that it was exactly the wrong decision, and he agreed that it was the wrong decision, but he defends very strongly the decision that Chief Coxswain Hunt made. But anyone reading the report as I did, you immediately come to the conclusion that he made that mistake. He should have been blamed. It was his fault. He made a technical error.
Let's go the right way, shall we?
Well, that sentence really, I ought to mention this. Sir John Simon, who was in charge of the Court of Inquiry, which he said, on inspection of one of these diagrams, produced by the NPL, it will be apparent that the plotted course of the ship most closely agrees with the actual course of events. In other words, he was quite satisfied that the NPL had predicted what the Court of Inquiry had found, and that justified the Court of Inquiry's conclusions. So he was more than happy. However, Williams and Collar, who did the calculations and published an R&M report, 1401, they said that all the above analysis, that's all these 14 calculations have done, definitely indicates that some additional assumptions other than loss of gas should be sought in order to explain the final motion of the airship before she struck the ground. So they were far from convinced that we got the right answer and felt that something was missing. I fancy they knew exactly what was missing. If you can't get an airship to go nose down, and the elevator is on the follow-up condition, it's because the elevator is full up. If the elevator wasn't full up, she would go nose down. And I think the engineers at NPL knew perfectly well that that was the case. I don't think they were allowed to make that calculation, because that would go against the findings of the Court of Inquiry. That's under my interpretation, it may not be true. Anyway, I'm not restricted, and I can make that assumption if I wish, which is what I did. The most telling evidence that the cable broke before the impact with the ground is from this diagram here. I mentioned earlier that she had shrunk 88 feet overall, and we can now, by looking at the position of the frames before and after the crash, we can determine how much each frame moved. And you can see on this top diagram that relative to the nose, frame 15, right at the back of the ship, moved a distance of 80 odd feet towards the nose. But frame 14, which is the frame on which the 2-to-1 reduction pulley is situated, that also moved a similar amount. They moved together. There was no axial movement between those two points. Frame 6 was, roughly speaking, where the control room was, and the helmsman, the control room, would be holding the elevator in the cover position. And that moved a distance of 40 odd feet towards the nose of the ship. So clearly, the contraction between the control room and the elevator was 45 feet or thereabouts. And if a cable moves 45 feet, there's 45 feet of slack in that cable. And although the helmsman might be, imagine he's holding the cable, the elevator in the follow-up condition, the weight of the cable, the weight of the elevator, would remove cable from the 2-to-1 reduction zone. The cable wasn't so removed, and so that's not a fitting explanation. I've done it again, I've pressed the wrong one. Some of these things are quite spectacular. I prepared a simple little diagram to explain what I've just said. A control room is at around about frame 6. And the height elevator, there's a separate height elevator and a rudder coxswain. There seems to have been a 2-to-1 pulley just outside the control room. There was then about 400 feet of cable, which took me right down to frame 15, where there was another 2-to-1 reduction pulley. And then there was another cable, which took me to drawn a very simple diagrammatic elevator arrangement. The whole thing, it's about this point here. It was found in fracture here, it was found in fracture here, but it was not really relevant. This fracture here is the important one. These two pulleys moved towards each other 45 feet. This cable was slack. there was no force in that cable. So the weight of this elevator acting downwards would remove cable from that drum. Those drums were found in a fully up condition. There was no cable removed from them. And therefore, this couldn't have happened. The only explanation would be that had this fracture in flight, then during the crash, if that was fractured, there'd be no force in this wire. These two pulleys would move forthrightly towards each other, so there would be no force in these wires. There would be no forces acting on this pulley, and therefore it would rotate. And if it was in the pulley up condition when this cable fractured, it would remain in the pulley up condition after the crash. And that, I think, is a perfectly sensible and reasonable interpretation of data from the crash. It doesn't rely on evidence and witnesses or anything like that. It just relies on the hard evidence that you get from the crash site. And I don't see how you can arrange it otherwise. The Court of Inquiry didn't think about this. Someone should have done, but they didn't. But I think that is the main evidence that the cable broke and brought down the crash. What I can do is to say, well, if the cable broke, supposing I repeat the calculations that were made by the NPL, and supposing I bring it down at an angle of 15 to 25 degrees, that would give supporting evidence that the cable was broken before the crash. And so that's what I did. I made minimum number of assumptions. The ship may be slightly heavy or slightly light. Squadron leader Booth, captain of the R100, did some calculations. He provided the data from the aircraft factory, and he knew what weight she was when she left the mast. He knew how much fuel, he calculated how much fuel she used as she went to Bay. He knew from his experience how much rain would gather on the outside of the ship in that sort of weather. And so he did an estimate of what the weight of the ship would be at the crash site. And he determined that it would be 4.2 tonnes. He rounded this up to a quarter. But since he calculated 4.2 tonnes, that's what I used. So I don't make any assumptions. I simply assume that it's 4.2 tonnes heavy. I should say that the NPL treated the heaviness or lightness of the ship as being a variable, and they chose the order between minus 10 degrees, 10 degrees light and 10 degrees, oh sorry, 10 tonnes light and 10 tonnes heavy, depending on how they felt and what they thought might bring the ship down in a suitable way. But you don't have to do this. You can take the captain of the R100's calculation, and that's the best estimate that you're going to get. As the ship flies along, the fuel is used from one bag and it starts to tilt. So he transfers fuel to another bag, and he tries to keep the thing in balance by pumping fuel and ballast about the ship during the flight. And he did an estimate of what he thought the captain of R101 would have done on the flight to Bowbury. He knew quite a lot about the flight, so he was able to do this. And he worked out that when she reached Bowbury, she would be 13.5 tonnes of ballast, and that's ignoring the ballast that was up in the nose that was never dropped. Then it was 13.5 tonnes of ballast, and he worked out its distribution along the ship. So if all that ballast was dropped, there would be a net moment up or down, and he worked out this moment was it 115 tonnes feet when you dropped all the ballast. So again, I don't have to assume to anything. The captain of the R100.
So in which direction was that room?
Nose up.
It's all nose up?
Yes, it's a nose up.
So what area is nose up?
Yeah, it's not Hudden.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well, that's what it says here. Yeah.
The NPL also treated the speed of the vehicle and the and its pitch angle and its elevator angle as an arbitrary constant. They just chose what they were balanced and thought might be appropriate over the crash site. They had no means of calculating what those values were. Well, it so happens that for equilibrium flight, it's flying horizontally against a steady wind, it's not pitching up or down, and it's not rising or falling, and it's not accelerating or slowing down. And it's in steady flight, in other words. You can work out, for any degree of heaviness, what the pitch angle and the elevator angle has to be, and that's what I've done using the program and the equations that the NPL supplied me with. And you can see that if the general heaviness was zero, if it was in balance, then you can see that the pitch angle was more or less horizontal and the elevator angle was more or less horizontal. And she would be traveling at a maximum speed of around about 90 feet per second, 88 feet per second is 60 miles an hour. 90 feet per second. If, however, she was 4.2 tonnes heavy, then the pitch angle would be about 1.3 tonnes, and the elevator angle would have to be about 6 tonnes. You have to go pitch up slightly, so that you get some lift, dynamic lift, which will balance the heaviness of the air of the ship. But by going pitch up, you introduce a pitching moment. And in order to cancel out the pitching moment, you need to adjust the elevator so that you stay at level. So you need to adjust both those two. And I've done the calculations from earlier. So I, knowing that the ship is 4.2 tonnes heavy, I also know what her velocity is and what the elevator angle and the pitch angle is. And I can use those in my computer simulations. I do, however, have to make some assumptions. And these are what I've done. Where do we start? The first 50 seconds, nothing happens. I do the calculation of equilibrium flight just to show that she's not increasing in height or decreasing in height or accelerating or by pitching. 50 seconds. First 50 seconds simply confirm that we have equilibrium flight. Where is Mark 1 there? In that 10 second period, one of the gas banks bursts and the gas leaks off to atmosphere over a period of 10 seconds. I assume, this is the assumption I have to make, I assume that it's gas bag 3 and that half the gas in the bag leaks off so that we lose 7 tonnes of lift. Gas bag five holds 14, has enough gas for 14 tonnes of lift. How much of that lift is lost in the hole? If the hole is at the top, we lose all of it. If the hole is at the bottom, we lose everything. I can see the hole is halfway up, and that you lose half of it. Whatever it's kind of missing. I've also assumed that another 2 tonnes of gas leaks out. And that this gas gets trapped between the outer cover and the gas bags. So as the ship moves, the gas moves up, the hydrogen moves up towards the tail, giving an additional nose down moment, which is what the NPL assumed. I doubt that that really happened. And so I did the calculation, ignoring the effect of hydrogen under the cover. I've done the calculation to both ways. I think you can see the blue line is the movement of the elevator. It starts off about 60 degrees down on the convention adopted by the NPL. A positive angle is down as well. It's 60 degrees down, and then it. About 20 or so seconds after the accident had occurred, they realised that something serious was happening and they were losing altitude. So they put the elevators up at the fastest rate as possible. According to the aircraft works,
fastest way possible was 1 degree per second. So we put it up at 1 degree per second until we got to be 20 degrees elevated power. The particular heaviness, in fact, is the black line at the top. There was no particular heaviness, i.e. none of the gas bags had burst. But at 30 seconds, the gas bag burst, and the particular heaviness increases by 7 tons and then remains constant. The general heaviness, as I say, is 4.2 tons. At the end of this period, when the elevator is being moved at 0.3 impact, I assume the cable breaks when it's 25 degrees up. When the cable breaks, it turns to zero at 1.3 impact. Once the cable is broken, Chief Coxon Hub would know immediately that it was broken. They normally have a servo-assisted elevator, because it's quite tough to move to the pull-up position. But they didn't have the servo assist, because it's been taken out. So the force required to hold the elevator in pull-up condition was very considerable. Once the cable broke, they would know immediately. The elevator went free. They knew they'd lost control of the ship. They knew that the ship would crash. There was no point in accelerating the ship and trying to recover altitude. Because they had no control of the altitude, they had no control of the ship. Chief Coxon Hutt then made the perfectly correct decision of making a soft landing, and he ordered the release of 13.5 tons of ballast. He sent Church forward to release the ballast in the nose, but Church never reached the nose before the crash happened. And he ordered all the engines to be stopped. These had to be signalled by telegraph one at a time, 5 engines. And one of them was still burning when the crash happened. So that period 4, I've marked on the graph there, is a period in which you're releasing ballast. Some of the ballast could be released from the control room, other have to be released locally. Period 5 indicates the period in which the engines were being shut off. 4 of the 5 engines were shut off during that period, one after the other. And then shortly after that, the crash happened. So that was the assumptions that I'm making, an absolute minimum number of assumptions in order to get what I believe to be the most reasonable prediction of the final moments of the airship. And this is what we calculate. The vertical scale here is the change in altitude. And the horizontal scale is time. I didn't bother working that distance, I just settled the time. The red scale is the ship's velocity, and the blue one is the altitude. And the dashed line and the solid line. The dashed line indicates the effect of the of hydrogen trapped in the under the covers of the airship, and it has a significant effect. But I prefer to ignore it. I don't think we do this. You can disagree with me if you wish. The airship uses about 400 feet, it's flying at 1200 feet, it uses 400 feet. 1200 feet isn't so high. I mean, this thing is 800 feet longer anyway. Mm-hmm. So it's only 1.5 times its length. It's quite amazing. Anyway, she uses about 400 feet in height. When they apply the elevator, I can hear it too here, there's some recovery. And it looks as if the airship is going to recover at altitude quite nicely at 0.3, except that that's where the cable breaks. And they are forced to drop the ballast and switch off the engines, with the result that they go through with some recovery of height, and then they lose a lot of height, and eventually they crash. They crash when they've lost 930 feet, if they were flying initially at 1200 feet. And 1230 feet if they were flying initially at 1500 feet. So the crash occurs at those periods there. We can now change over to one of the other graphs, which shows you the pitch angle, the all important pitch angle. We have to ideally crash the airship at 15 to 25 degrees. And you can see that for the first 50 seconds, nothing's happening. She's flying a constant dip. And then she loses, the pitch angle goes down, then recovers fairly massively. And then there's a big drop. This is the last of the engine, last of the four engines is switched off. And shortly after that, there's impact with the ground, and these are the impact points. If we ignore the effect of hydrogen, we find it impacts with the ground at about minus 21 degrees, 21 degrees nose down, which is exactly what the protein inquiry wanted. So this, I believe, is very strong supporting evidence that the cable must have been controlled the crash. If you take hydrogen into account, hydrogen under the cover, and it crashes at 25 degrees nose down. She's still within, in fact, it's 25.1 degrees, I think. Yes. Or 25.3 degrees. It's just beyond the 25 degrees limit that the protein inquiry said. But I'm willing to accept that as being a reasonable error. Bearing in mind that Robert Louis here, who actually saw the crash, of course, it came down at 28 degrees. So that is very strong evidence that the crash did indeed occur as a result of the drop earlier cable breaking. So we have two very strong pieces of evidence that this was so. There's one strong piece of evidence that it wasn't so, and that's the brittle failure of the cable itself. Yes, I'm about to, we're pleased to know that I'm about to finish. The brittle failure of the cable itself. How do we explain this? Well, if you look on the internet for failure of zinc-plated bolts or the zinc-plated stud or zinc-plated wire, you will find there are lots of descriptions of brittle failure of those objects. It's in fact quite common. How does it occur? Well, it occurs through hydrogen embrittlement, of course. Experiment at school, I expect, which a double burette pipe is filled with water, and there's a pair of electrodes in there. And when you switch on the current, oxygen begins to form above the positive electrode, and the hydrogen forms above the hydrogen forms above the negative electrode. It's an old establishment. I mean, an old established experiment. It's been around for. Over 200 years, I think. Anyway, if you, if you replace these electrodes by a zinc plate here and a steel plate here, and you get rid of the current supply, then we have a simple battery. In the galvanic series, zinc is slightly more positive than steel, so there will naturally be a half volt difference. Oxygen will form above the zinc, hydrogen will form above the steel. And if you transfer that to our wire, our broken wire, you can imagine that the steel wire here is a negative electrode, of course. It's zinc plated. And if that zinc is fractured or broken at any point, exposing the steel wire, and the thing becomes damp in the atmosphere, then you have a natural battery, a natural cell. And oxygen will form on the zinc, and it will react with the zinc to form zinc oxide. And in fact, when they tested the wires from the ship, they found zinc oxide on the wire. That's one of the corrosion products of the marker. Hydrogen, there's still hydrogen there, because the hydrogen died of the dash of what took into the atmosphere, or it diffused into the steel. hydrogen diffuses into steel very easily. Hydrogen is a very small atom, and it will very easily, very readily diffuse between the atoms of the atomic structure of steel. So you don't need many parts per million of hydrogen in steel before you have steel in little heat. And so that, I think, is a reasonable assumption that that could have happened. These ships were hanging around for, the R101 was hanging around for about a year before it finally flew. And during that time, it could have damaged its cable. There's another mechanism. The R101 had gas bags that were full of holes. And there was a lot of gas leaking all over the ship for a long time. It's quite possible that hydrogen surrounding the wire could embed it. As I say, if you go on the internet, you'll find it's almost any contact with a zinc plating steel component and hydrogen will result in its embedment. It's quite common. So I believe that the cables are already embedded. And the airship took off, needing to happen. You don't need the fire in order to produce hydrogen and lithium. It could have happened earlier and been in existence when the ship took off. And that, I think, is almost all I have to say on water, except drawing a few conclusions. I think the assumption that wire glow, of course, the second diagram here is consistent with the cable's position on the elevator bones after the hull of the telescope. If the hull, this shows a miraculous predicts the firing motion of the airship, whereas the NPL were unable to do that. The simple assumption achieves it very readily. In fact, I could have shown you one of half a dozen ways in which it could have been brought down between 15 and 25 degrees. There are lots of ways in which it could have happened. I've shown you the one which I believe makes the minimum number of assumptions, but there are many other possibilities. So it's consistent with the physical evidence from the wreck, and it doesn't rely on the doubtful evidence, in my view. There's another important conclusion, I think. Chief Cox and Hunt have decided to cut the engines and drop ballast, and if it's an elevator cable broke, then that is exactly the right decision to be made. There's nothing else you can do. Had we gone on to go to various islands, then the logical thing for him to do would be to accelerate the ship and recover her oxygen, but he didn't do that. So there's an implied criticism there. The court didn't make that criticism.